recall the September 1st meeting of the City Council Finance Committee to order. Introduces everybody. Councilor LaBarge, I'm Councilor Murphy. Councilor Jesse Adams. And Gina Louise Scarrow, who's back fresh from vacation and all recharged. That's our roll call. I'm going to announce that we are audio and video recording the meeting. We are taking minutes, so we'll have word for word in minutes of everything that happened. And it's not on here normally. We have public comment, but there's no public in the room at the moment, so we're not going to have any public comment. So the purpose of our meeting is interviews with the firms that sent in proposals to us for doing the municipal audit for 3 years. And the first firm here is Powers and Sullivan. And you're Mr. Powers?
Yes, I'm Mr. Powers.
Great. Well, please, we'll start off by letting you make any kind of a presentation you want to make to us, and then we'll ask questions.
So,
right, just stand up at the podium and give us your name so that for identification purposes of the video, we can figure out who's who if we need to try and fix the minutes. And if you have handouts, we're happy to have handouts.
Thank you. My name is Jim Powers from Powers and Sullivan, a partner with the firm. And also with me is Craig Peacock, also a partner. And in the proposal, both of us were assigned to the audit, if we get that. We've passed out a little handout, basically a PowerPoint presentation. It's more kind of a summary and highlights of what our proposal stated as we go through. And I can take through that.
Sure, go right ahead.
Anything you'd like to have half an hour, so.
Yeah, right, and anything you'd like to, just leave a little time for questions, but the time is yours, and we'll ask you questions when you're done.
Okay, and if you want to, as you go through, if you have a question as we go through, it's obviously a small enough meeting that it wouldn't be that disruptive as we do that. So, the objective tonight is obviously to explain in person to you what we propose, who we are, what we do, and why Powers and Sullivan in Northampton is a good fit and a go-forward basis, and the services we can offer you, and the benefits that you can receive from your audit firm. One of the big mistakes I find a lot of people take a look at an audit firm is sometimes they view us as the enemy, and that we're just here to come up with findings and go through and try to find catches and things like that. No, our purpose and our role is obviously we're independent, number one, and that's really critical because if we're not independent, we lose all credibility. We don't work necessarily, we work for the city, and obviously the finance committee, it seems, is going to be the liaison people. So we take our direction from you, we do our planning with you, we make sure you understand our audit process, what we're planning to do, and if you have any suggestions for changes, then we go through that. But we're also here to help you become more efficient and leverage our experience that you'll find as reading our proposals and our discussions tonight. But sometimes in different communities throughout the state, you'll find that we find things that people do very well that will help you become more efficient, do things a little bit better, strengthen your internal controls without having to spend a lot of money to implement them, because we understand the city and town environment, and as such, we can't just go by the book and open up an internal control handbook and say, these are the 9 things that you need to do. In order to do that, to segregate the duties, you need to hire 3 more people. Well, we know that's really not going to happen in this environment. And so we try to put ourselves in your position to sit back and say, how can I best influence the direction of how the internal controls go to maximize the benefits, but obviously make it a practical solution? Roles that we're going to play as we go through this is I'll be what's called a concurring the engagement partner, and my responsibility will be to make sure that I review all of the audit work papers, review the reports, and really play an integral part in that, to attend all meetings and also to spend some time on site, but not as much as Craig, the secondary partner, the on-site partner. We'll be in charge of the day-to-day field work as we're out here and even back at the office. We work as a team, One of the things that you'll find when we talk about our bench strength and who we are, we've been doing this for a long time, is that we always assign two partners to pretty much every engagement, every audit engagement, even the small communities. Just because needs arise as the year goes through, even as part of your request for proposal, you said that the audit firm needs to be available throughout the year. To answer questions, to help you things come up, we are there. But sometimes we go on vacation, so we just go back from vacation, and you may not have wanted to get a phone call. I could be down in the Bahamas, not reachable, but you know Craig is there, and you can always reach Craig, or you can always reach me, and that if you had a question specific to Northampton, you have someone knowledgeable in what you do, the players who's doing what, and the controls that are in place. I think that's very important. What you'll also find is that we've been doing this for a long time. I've been doing this for longer than I tend to realize sometimes. And Powers and Sullivan has been Powers and Sullivan for over 25 years. And we started as a municipal firm. I started the firm back after I left what is now Deloitte. It used to be Touche Ross, one of the big eight accounting firms that was in charge of the governmental audits way back in the a long time ago. Also worked for the city of Boston in the auditors department, and I was in charge of the municipal department. Broke out on my own back in 1987. I had been managing the state's audit, Commonwealth of Massachusetts, switched up that, and in late 1999, Richard Sullivan joined me as a partner and became Powers and Sullivan right about the start of 1990. We specialize in doing municipal audits and consulting, et cetera. What you'll find is that 95% of our work is dedicated to this particular environment, especially in Massachusetts. We do over 60 every year, different audits of cities, towns throughout the Commonwealth, as large as Springfield. We've been Springfield's auditors for several years. We've been reappointed after competitive bids, et cetera. And so we're in this area all the time. We've been in Agawam, Lowell Pioneer Valley Educational Collaborative. And so we are used to being out there. We do communities all over the state. And we have the resources and the knowledge and the benchmark to get these things done. We have about 25 full-time professionals. Everybody audits municipalities. We have a small tax practice, but you will not get people that have not audited municipalities. You will not get questions that will sit back and say, what's a warrant? You know, what's an article? What is this? What's a council vote? How does this thing work? We provide training to our staff every year. It's a 2 or 3 day training session along with the going through. That what we do is we teach the municipal audits. We do that in June of every year. We ask our staff every year to say, what do you need to know and learn? Again, you say, well, why is that important? It can be very disruptive to the day-to-day. Auditing is something that's an interactive process. We can't audit alone. We have to interact with your employees. We will not just do this all by the internet and send us emails, etc. We have to be in place on site, and you will see us, you will know us, and you will have us available face-to-face for any problems that you have throughout the year. We also meet all the deadlines. Because we do this all the time, we know what needs to be done. I think we've put together a realistic time budget for a community our size. With the, you know, and again, not extremely complex, but the city is growing. It's got a water, sewer, enterprise fund, landfill. Obviously, there's some issues relative to that with go forward basis, closing this down, and doing a few other things as you go forward. That'll need some expertise relative to that. The implementation of new GASBs are very important. What you'll also find is part of our staff, that we've got a lot of our staff, almost half of our professional staff, are certified public accountants. We hire kids out of school for every year. They have to learn, but we give them appropriate roles to make sure that we're not sending them out to complete the financial statements. They're doing some of the basic work that has to be done. Coffee machine is always there. One of the other things that we do, we're completely paperless. We would rather not have, we're a little bit green in that. We have been that for over 10 years. And we want to make sure that whatever we can get electronically, we want that. We don't want paper for a variety of reasons. It's obviously easy to work with, but obviously there's a little bit of, I don't like paper from this, but I use, you know, just to use paper, even though I did hand out some presentations today, but that's just what we do. The other thing too is that we audit, and if you went through our proposal, and hopefully, I'm sure you did, you can see the size of the communities that we do. When you're running into the $100 million range, we do more $100 million communities than anybody else. I don't know if you're familiar with comprehensive annual financial reports, if you're ever interested in doing that. I think we did 18 last year, Craig?
And we did 19. We're on track for 21 for fiscal 15.
Okay, and again, it's a different level of report. It would cost a little bit more money if you wanted to do that, but it's certainly there. And so we're familiar with communities your size. We're financially solid. Like I said, we've been in business for a long time, and I have two kids just about ready to go to college, one in law school and one going to medical school, so I need a job for my few kids, so I'm not worried about that. And so, you know, I'll still be around for a little bit. I don't think they're going to Smith, I wouldn't mind if they did, but obviously, a big part of what's going on up here is obviously a college community. Things that are also important, we audit all kinds of retirement systems. New GASBs that are coming up, obviously GASB 68, where now you have to put the pension liabilities on there. We've already audited and completed regional retirement systems, what needs to be done for that, for both Barnstable County and Barnstable and Essex County retirement system. We're just about ready to issue Middlesex counties. Dukes counties is just about ready to issue. And we also have a proposal in with Hamlin County to do this. We have already issued the GASB 68 information. And on a local level, you're easier because you're 95% Northampton and 5% for your housing authority. So the split is not that difficult, but it is important to do that right because 5% of that $50, $60 million liability becomes material to your financial statements and extremely important to the housing authority's financial statements. So you have to make sure that you're familiar with that, know what to do, and where it has occurred. Other things that you'll find is as future GASBs are approaching, obviously it looks like you started an OPEB trust fund as part of that. And it looks like you put $100,000 in that. At least I saw it. I mean, the notes were a little bit confusing because I didn't see the fund, but I saw the notes at $100,000 contribution into that. What you do there, how you implement that, because in fiscal year 18, OPEB is required to be implemented. That's going to have a more significant impact on your financial statements than pensions. The liability is double. The discount rate you're using right now is too high, even if you're putting a little bit in there. And so that $108 million liability that you right now are disclosing, realistically, your discount rate can't be 4% that you're using. More realistically, it would be more of 2.5% to 3, which would increase that liability significantly, probably about 25%. So this is the new rules that are coming on board. So plan for those particular things. You'll find that we're on top of that. Actually, I'm meeting with the Public Employee Retirement Administration Commission tomorrow, PERAC, to go over GASB 67 and 68 with their staff to talk about what they invited me in to sit back and say, what do we need to change in order to be compliant and make life a lot easier for all the retirement systems. Those are the type of things that we do all the time. Again, like I said, we look at this as a team effort. One of the things that's extremely important when you do an audit, and especially with a new audit firm, I know you've been with an audit firm for a while, the transition can be scary. We do this all the time. We shoulder most of that burden. We go through and we have tried to handbooks that we put up, an audit manual that goes through and explains what we need, why we need it, timing. We delegate the responsibility, a lot of that on us, as much as we can, a burden, you know, we'll take that burden on. And the things that you need to do in the timing when we lay out the time. Planning is extremely important. Like I said earlier, we plan this all the time. We work with audit committees finance committees, et cetera, all the time, and we will go over our audit plan up front. What are we going to do? When are we going to do it? Do you understand what's going to be done? What are your responsibilities? These are not our financial statements. We'll help you prepare those, but these are your financial statements, and what has to go into it, and what's coming down the road. And planning just doesn't stop. You know, we come in, obviously this year would be a little bit different because of the time, but normally we do that all in the spring. We do that all right away. One of the other things, because of who we are and what we do and our resources we have, if we're selected, we can start right away. Okay, but we won't wait, we're not sitting back. We have room for fixing the schedule. We'll squeeze you in there. I'm not saying it'll be the normal, smooth audit that would normally occur, but it will happen and we will start right away on that. And again, part of the adjustments that we've talked about, most of those are not that difficult, but they are audit adjustments. We'll walk you through that. What you'll also find is we may not do the same things that your previous auditor did. We'll look at different things. I know the RFP says you're going to go take a look at 4 or 6 different places to give you an evaluation, a little site visit to make sure that internal controls are important. We'll also do some surprise ones. We'll sit back and say, hey, let's plan a couple of things. And because if you know what the auditors are going to do every year, it's pretty easy to hide. I say, if I only ask for this and I do this every year. So we may switch things up depending on what we find and how we go about that. Not that we're going to completely surprise everybody all the time, but we do a risk evaluation, which you should be doing yourself as part of our management, whether it's part of what Craig put together as part of the proposal. How do you evaluate risk internally? What does a business normally do for risk evaluation? How do you monitor that? How do you decide whether or not there are serious deficiencies in internal controls? Now, we didn't see any of that in the prior management letter, so our expectations are that we won't find those, but we may look at different things and hopefully can add value by going through that particular single audit, the federal audit. Again, completely familiar with it. We do a million of those each year. Nothing that we saw on here that would cause us any concern. Even with the two different school districts that are part of Northampton, a little bit unusual that has that. We have a similar type thing, City of Quincy. They have the only college in the country that's under a city control. And so they have the regular school district. We've got a Quincy College down there. And so it's two different reports. And so, although not the same, anyway, it's not that big a deal. Things that we'd also like to sit back and go through is just talk about other things that we could help you with. Looking at the financial statements, Craig and I have some suggestions to help the transparency of a lot of the reports. I know we have a combining schedule in the back. That's an old DOR schedule that's always been there. There are better ways to do that to make it more meaningful. So a combining schedule of revenues and expenses and if you're non-major funds, you may want to break out the two different school districts and their operations in the back of the report. Not required to show it up front, but you may want to show that because the reader may have some interest in it. Community preservation funds. Obviously, you're over $3 million in funding at the end of 14. I don't know what you did in 15, but it looks like you're building up for something. You may want to show that as a major fund so the reader can see something that's important part of what's going on. So those are the type of suggestions, although not really audit suggestions, but depending on what you want to do. Even if you don't want to do a CAFR, we put together and help you do your management discussion and analysis, but you may want to put in a transmittal letter that explains what's going on in Northampton. In plain English, that goes through and says, this is what's going on, this is what's happening, this is our expectations, this is where we're going, this is what happens in the future, because financial statements as they are, they're pretty dry, okay? And unless you do this for a living, especially with governmental financial statements, even if you're the best business person in the world, and again, when they take a look at governmental financial statements, they say, what the heck's going on here? We've had several meetings with the audit committees, et cetera, with the 100% of the meeting just to go over their financial statements so they understand what everything means. What is this really showing me? What is the fund base showing me? What is this showing me? What are my cash flows showing me? a lot of things like that. I think we can add value to as you go through. So that leaves about 10 minutes of time. And I think one of the things I do want to say, I'll say at the end, we're in Wakefield. We're out here all the time. This we have the state of Massachusetts is the area that we're in. We're down the Vineyard, we're down the Cape, we're all over the state. Our largest client for the last 10 years in the city of Springfield. It's not too far from here. So we're in this area, one of the partners on Springfield have been for years, and so if that's a concern relative to what we do, we're priced it accordingly. We'll make sure that we have enough money in the budget to do everything that we need to do. Our people, when they come up, stay. It's not that bad a commute. Craig and I made it a great time today. However, things happen, especially if we're doing things during the week. But we will be here. We will be on site. Whatever we can do off site, depending on what goes on, we will do. We'll plan to do things up front, but it's a year-long engagement. So we'd love to have the city as one of our clients. And so if you want to open up questions.
Yeah, just quickly, you've got a retirement system because not everybody has one of those. Yeah. And our two unusual two school districts.
Right.
And your proposal includes doing our free cash and our balance sheet.
Yeah, that's not okay. Okay.
That's it.
Yeah, because the state is actually lost a lot of the reps because of the early retirement incentive mm-hmm. that I've been working with Sean Cronin at the department to find out better ways to help them get done. But they used to be with 20 people, now with 10.
Mm-hmm.
And so there's a crunch on this year, and they've got some things in place on a go-forward basis, simplifying the free cash balance sheets and maybe integrating that. So,
okay.
Not a problem there. Yeah.
So go around and see if we have any questions. Councilor Dean?
Yeah, I have some. Apparently you've had a chance to look at the city's website, and you looked at the previous reports of the auditing being done in the city, mm-hmm. correct?
Yeah.
Is what type of changes would you consider after looking at that?
In the financial statements themselves? Well, one of the things that I'd probably do, if you go to the statement of activities, and that's the full accrual basis for financial statements. The purpose of the statement of activities is to show, in effect, the net cost of providing a particular service. So say for education, one of the things your taxpayers would want to know is that I've got an education line item. And the way that report is structured, it says, okay, there's, you know, $50 million worth of education expense. We've got program revenues for grants that come in, some revolving funds that may, you know, some school lunch, things like that, and capital grants, and it gives you a net expense. Well, one of the problems that you have right now is that you've got about $30 million worth of employee benefits, health insurance, the gross up, state kind of tax. All those expenses are supposed to be allocated to each program level. So it doesn't really show the true cost of what's self-supporting and then what's supporting through general revenues. You have your tax base, you've got about 62-63% of your general funds taxes is through taxes, it's supported by taxes. It's not a huge, you know, it's a good amount, not as high as some other places, and you've got the Chapter 70 money, school grants, etc., motor vehicle taxes, but how much is really on your tax bill to support this function? If you don't allocate up and up to all those other indirect costs, there's a pension cost. Somebody's working for the school, or somebody's working for the police, there's a pension cost associated with that. There's a health insurance cost associated with that. So I would move all of those up. Things I mentioned earlier, things that would change, I would recommend, especially if your CPA fund is going to do a lot, to show that as a major fund. Although it doesn't hit the requirements of the 10%, there's a gap requirement that says it hits 10% of, you know, all these different elements, then it must be shown. But it also allows you the ability to put anything you want in there if you think of a particular concern relative to do that. I would take a look at the indirect costs that you're allocating between the water and sewer fund and now and the landfill fund. And to look at that, is that a true number? Are you billing too much, too little? What is it based? Is it done on a consistent level? Does it meet the requirements of both the GASB and the DOI requirements? I'd make sure that was looked at. what other things? I mean, so those are the major ones that probably take a look. Yeah, I mean, things that I couldn't come out of that, their transfers, and the note was very, it didn't explain enough why the transfers were made. For the landfill, I'd rewrite the landfill note, because there's a lot of things in there. I was trying to figure out where you were with the landfill and all the different cells and as it was going through. And then I read in the back that the landfill was closed at the end of June 30th, 14th. Now, if that's the case, there's a lot of things that have to go into it, because it looks like you have enough revenue and cash aside to close the landfill and pay for all the debt service. But I think that's the more important thing, not where you've been, but it's really where you're going. And so those are the type of things that make some adjustments to.
Councilor Adams, you have a question?
You said you're familiar with helping cities transition from one auditing firm to another.
Mm-hmm.
You've done that many times?
We've got over 100 clients, and so it happens every year that we get several. So we do a general planning meeting with the people above, but then we get down into the detail with the people that actually about to do the work, that are hired to do the work, and explain to them and take the fear out of them. From the standpoint of, if you do what you're supposed to do, now there's no material weakness and significant deficiencies in the previous auditor's report. So I imagine cash is being reconciled, receivables are being reconciled. I don't see a high balance in receivables. It looks like things are being collected. They probably get transferred to tax title. They're being marked at the registry. All the things you're supposed to do, looks like it's being done, is probably being done well. If that occurs, it's really nothing to fear. You only have a few gap adjustments. One of the big ones, obviously, is the new GASB, the 67, 68. We'll take care of all of that. One of our jobs, one of the biggest jobs we have, is to help you understand your financial statements. Because somebody in here needs to take responsibility for those particular financial statements. They're not ours. And so we'll make sure that they understand where these adjustments are coming from and how they're coming to be. But just the gap pieces, because realistically, 90% of your financial statements is what you do day to day. The last 10% is only on a few of the reports. It's really not that difficult, but it can be pretty scary from that standpoint.
The reason why I ask is because one of the questions we've had, and one of the things we've heard from members of the administration's finance team, is that there would be some sort of transition period, so that might require more time and effort on their part. But so that's why I asked that question. Could you also answer for me, in your experience, mm-hmm. I'm sure this varies, from what you've seen, we've been with the same firm for 25 plus years. Do you see a variance between what the various, how long various communities stay with an auditor for?
We've had clients that we've had for 20 years. Answer you honestly, because obviously it's my best interest to say, oh, you should change after that. You take a look at the audit firm. Do you think they're doing a good job? Are they fresh? Are they doing the things you want them to do? Are they coming up with innovative ideas? Are they looking at things different? One of the things that we do all the time, and it happens to a lot of our firms, is we, say for the 20-year, Andover's, for example, I just transitioned from one of my other partners. We won in a competitive bidding process, but we had them for over 10 years, and I'm the third partner that's on that engagement. They wanted a different set of eyeballs on me. So we're wide enough from a firm side to, in effect, rotate clients individually. If you're happy with your audit firm, you don't fire your attorney for doing a good job. And again, that's what I tell my clients, so I'm not going to tell you anything different. But having a different set of eyes on the same thing, there's a benefit to that.
From your experience, what's a shorter period of time that you've seen communities transition?
Oh, a year. Because what they told the client they were going to do.
I don't mean in a situation where an auditing firm was deficient.
Oh, okay.
Maybe because new set of eyes. Because it seems here, you may know this. It seems that in Northampton, there have not been really any complaints about scandal. If we were to switch, it would probably be based on just for the purpose of a new set of eyes, and of course, considering the finances.
Yeah. I mean, I know Tom, I respect him, and so it's not, you know, I would be surprised if he was disappointed.
Right, but I'm just telling you that just because we would be changing solely to have a new set of eyes. So, from your experience, what have you seen with respect to
the shortest period of time is we have some couple school districts do a 3-year rotation. They have 3 years, and what we find is that they switch from us to another firm, back to us, back to the other firm. Mm-hmm. Okay, and it's not necessarily price, but and again, that is I don't agree with that as being the best way to do it. Maybe a 5-year to an 8. A lot of the audit committees that go through, as part of their charter, they sit back and say every like 8 or 9 years, we must revisit and go out to bid. Every 6 years, we must go out to bid again. We can't, even though we don't have to, we want to take a look to see whether or not it's time for a change. And a lot of it becomes a different set of eyes, and there's obviously a lot of support for that. In most of the places, that's if I can say, hey, maybe we should just get a different set of eyes on that. So hopefully that helps answer your question.
Thank you.
I'm just curious if you have any questions.
I mean, my only question was along the same lines as Councillor Adams, which is you started off saying that, you know, often people view their auditors as it's sort of an adversarial relationship,
right.
And I can say that it's actually the opposite here. You know, we've had a very, very comfortable, good working relationship for longer than we maybe even know. I mean, I think you've largely answered this, but that, so one, you know, I think a new set of eyes is good, and we're not looking for that sort of adversarial situation, but, you know, while I want to make sure that it's a comfortable transition for everybody, we do want, you know, some new blood in there.
Yeah, if you don't mind asking you a question, I mentioned audit committees, and obviously the finance committee, the finance side of it. As part of that, have you historically made the decision to hire the audit firm? Because I think as we talk about internal controls and segregation of duties, that's important for your financial operations. It's the same thing here, that the audit firm should be reporting to a body outside of management. That to me is I love when there's audit committees, because I don't want to be hired by, you know, the town manager, the city mayor, you know, the mayor, et cetera. I'd rather be.
It's our charter now. We have a new charter, and the new charter assigns it to us.
And so that makes all the difference in the world, because now we're coming to you, as it said in the RFP, with the draft management letter to go over the points and to go through that. So, and you get to ask us the questions directly. One of the biggest problems, especially in the early days when we did that, is. And especially during good times when everybody had all kinds of money and the budget wasn't tight, we'd do the audit and then just pass them out and nobody would look at them. And then all of a sudden you have a bad time. Things happen and you get, why didn't you tell us? Let me take a look at my last 7 management letters. So those are the type of things that really complement each other. That now that you go through and you had a child change, I think that is what we would prefer to see.
It's specifically assigned to us now under the charter.
Right.
Councilor, do you have another question?
Yes. How long do you think it would take if we agree in full city council of accepting you as our ongoing business? I am very concerned because I did hear Councilor Jean Louis Sharon talk about having a very comfortable transition. And I have talked with some department heads in regards to a transition. How long is it going to take you to go into the departments, talk with department heads and staff? How long?
Oh, less than a day.
Okay.
It's really not that. The department heads, there's only so much information that you really need from the department heads. Well, you're going to get into the transition, which is a little bit different, was the request to go out and take a look at their individual operations.
Right, that's what I'm saying. You're going to have to go into those departments.
Right.
Okay. You're going to have to sit down, look at their books. You're going to have to be able to consult with counselors to say, well, I found a problem. We need to do more training or teach them how to go ahead and change the system that they're doing. That's not going to happen overnight.
There's different levels and risk factors when you take a look at an audit. The site visit you're talking about, say if you went to a recreation department, depending on how big the recreation department is, or the Council on Aging.
Or the Board of Public Works.
The Department of Public Works. And again, we have to understand who does the billing, how things occur, et cetera. Some of them aren't material to the actual financial statements. So we can get the financial statements done with very little interaction outside of the auditor, either the treasurer, the collector, the accountant, the auditor's office, and things like that, and visits to departments. Those site visits usually only last a day to go through that. If something, has that occurred before? Site visits like that, you're questioning right now.
Yes.
Okay, so you did that every year? That people
would
go.
But the department vary, you know, the.
Okay.
Right.
And so they're already used to it. It's just a different team going out, probably doing about the same thing with a different set of eyes.
Right.
That's not the transition. The transition that becomes a little bit harder is the actual financial statements become a little bit more difficult because you get information from a variety of different sources. Mm-hmm. And a day to go through that with the departments to explain what we're going to do, how we're going to do it. And then what we do is we manage that through, all right, you're on vacation. And those type of site visits do not have to happen all in one day and things like that. We schedule around other people's schedules.
And just to remind everybody, we're talking about, this is a 2016 audit we're hiring for.
Right,
so it's like a year
ago.
Right.
Another question I have, are you willing to negotiate your proposed price?
Always willing to negotiate proposed price. And depending on what it is, if you're asking me to take, you know, because don't forget, as part of this proposal, you know, we've got new gaskets coming on board, new single audit things that haven't been here before. You also have, again, new standards create a lot more work. You've got two DESE reports as part of that. You've got your free cash submission and things like that. So we've priced this, what I think is right, for about $500 to get everything done. Am I going to be dropping $15,000, $20,000 off the price? No. Will I work with you to, you know, fit within your budget over the next few years? Yes. But, you know, if you're looking for us to say, all right, you bid at $65,000, can you do it for $40,000? We will say, you know, thank you for the opportunity, but that we can't make money. If we don't make money, we're not in business this long.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And what you have to understand a lot of times is there's a value to experience, a value billing. There's very few things I haven't seen or Craig hasn't seen. And that comes from the fact that we're always speaking. I was at UMass speaking to the treasurers a couple of weeks ago on Gadget 67, 68, etc. You call me up 95% of the time, I have the answer. The tip of my tongue. Because I've seen it, I've done. It's not work to go over and do this thing. And you get the answer right away. And not to say that, you know, Tom can't do that, etc. He's been doing this a long time too. But I'm just saying that we have that ability, and you have several partners. Even if Craig and I, you can't get, you've got Dick Sullivan, you got Renee Davis, you got Mike Melody, you got Frank Cervetti, you know, right down the line, there are people that would pick up all of them. I had a client call me the other day because he couldn't get home from my partner who was on vacation, and the other partner was at a council meeting. I took the phone call. I know the client, but I'm not one of the partners assigned. Had the answer for him in 2 hours and all the legal things that he needed to have done. There's a value to that, and that's what we provide, the value-added services. I know we're going
over. You're about 10 minutes over. Do you have any last questions for us? Anything you want to know from us before we?
Well, hey, like I said earlier, we would love to have you as a client. It fits in nice. The size of the client, what mm-hmm. we're used to, we believe we can add value to that. It is not too far to be out mm-hmm. here. The fact that it's a 16 audit, you know how easy that makes the transition? Like I said, we can start next week, but we'll be starting the planning process and make that transition.
Because it, you know, it's
and
a
so
year
sit
away.
Back, yeah, it's a year away, but we'll do all of those site visits over the winter. Mm-hmm. When are you least busy? Oh, we'll set up a team. We'll go over to Public Works, we'll go here, we'll go there at that point in time. It makes life a lot easier because it's still a year away. So, and thank you for
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
All right.
All right.
Thank you very much.
Take care. Do you need any more of these handouts or this?
We're good.
You're good?
Okay. We're good. Thank you.
Okay. Yeah, how you doing?
Good, how are you?
Good.
Hello.
Good, how are you?
I'm fine.
Oh, hi,
Peter. I knew who you were because I recognized your picture.
That's awful picture.
But the finance committee's waiting.
Certainly.
Hello.
Hello, how are you?
Very well.
Good.
Keep you waiting.
Yeah, we're keeping you waiting. So what we'll let you do is present, and we'll give you a full half hour. We won't rip you off for any time here.
We appreciate that.
We are, just so you know, we are audio, video, recording, taking minutes, doing all kinds of things.
All right.
So why don't you take what you think is appropriate time to go over what you're giving us.
Sure.
And then we'll ask you some questions, and then we'll let you follow up.
All right. Sounds like a plan. Are we on the...
You're on there.
We're checking. We're on the clock. All right. My name is Pat Spalante. I'm a partner with Melanis and Heath. With me today is Tanya Campbell. She's one of our managers from the municipal side of our practice. I want to thank you, actually, for inviting us to the interview and for inviting us to propose. We definitely appreciate the opportunity and consideration. Give you a little background. I have been with Melanis for a little over 27 years. Tanya has been in the field for 11 years, the last 9 of which have been with Melanis. Firm-wide, Melanis & Heath is considered a large regional CPA firm. We have 5 offices throughout New England. Tanya and I are both from the Greenfield office, which is right up the road, obviously. Firm-wide, we do over 100 Massachusetts municipality audits. That's cities, towns, school districts, local schools. We do that each year. I have 100 firm-wide. Our office in Greenfield handles about 40 of those. Our clients are have a pretty diverse client base that we service out of our office. We audit several larger cities like Holyoke and Pittsburgh. We also do medium sort of sized towns like Amherst. And we do small towns like my hometown of Burnston. Do that every 3 years. So I think that sort of diverse client base, I think, gives us a broader perspective on issues that, you know, are certainly going to cut across any community of any size, you know, DOR regulations, federal changes in the federal grant laws, that sort of thing. And then, you know, it also, I think, gives us a window into different levels of sophistication, technology, that sort of thing. And, you know, oftentimes what we learn at one client, or if we see something that one client's doing really well, we can pass that along to all our other clients. One of the things that I think that we are unique in and that we can offer Northampton is the combination of a local office and a local firm with the depth of a large firm. So I think in that you get the benefits that are normally associated with a local firm or a local office. You have local, you know, it's local staff, it's local people, you know, by and large people who have either grown up here or you know, lived a big chunk of their lives here. You know, I'm originally from New Jersey, so I'm you know, the odd one, but I've been here for 30 years, which almost makes me close to a native, but not quite. I know that, so, because my neighbors will tell me that. Plus, the name Scalante in Franklin County is a little odd, so. So the local aspect of it, I think, is important because, you know, we're familiar with the area, we're familiar with issues that face Western Mass, you know, you couple that with the depth that we have in our firm. We have 5 partners that specialize in municipal and nonprofit audit and consulting. Each one of them has their own specialty. Mine, for example, is federal grant compliance auditing. I'm the one who sets our protocol firm-wide for ensuring that we are in compliance with whatever the latest standards are. One of my partners is his expertise is in fraud and forensics and in developing, for example, risk assessment programs that some of our clients have used internally to try to address their areas of concern. One of the other partners is, his area of expertise is emerging standards, accounting and auditing standards. So he's our GASB guy, he's the guy we go to for Government Accounting Standard Board, which is the body that sets the rules that you have to live by. And, you know, I think importantly, you know, he's not only letting the staff know and making sure we're all updated on the standards that are in effect right now, but even more importantly to me is the him, you know, looking at the ones that are coming 3 years down the road so that, you know, if there's something our clients need to do, they can do it now. We have another one of my partners, it dove headfirst into the GASB standards that affect your retirement system. And as you may be aware, it's GASB 67-68, and they have tremendously expanded the amount of testing and reporting and so forth related to your retirement system. Very complicated stuff. You know, they're talking about a lot of the actuarial terms and all of that. So he, you know, he dove right in and became the expert on it. You know, he's done a number of presentations, including one to PARAC on their emerging issues forum. So, you know, the odds are that if I don't know the answer to something, one of my partners does. And, you know, in addition to that, we have teams within, underneath the partners that also, you know, sort of specialize in different types of clients. For example, we have a team that deals with schools, a lot of the school issues. You know, they were have worked extensively with MASBO and with DESC and with Jay Sullivan to set protocols for end-of-year testing, compliance testing, for the student activity fund testing that is became enforceable in the last year or so. We have a team that does a number of electric light departments, which is a very unique sort of random, you know, kind of thing, but they're, you know, they're the one, if I have a question about it or a client does, they're the ones I'm going to. So I think, you know, overall, you have that, what I think is a very attractive combination of, you know, local knowledge, local people, and, you know, the depth of a 100-person firm. So I think we're really the whole package. I think I was going to have Tanya actually talk about customer service and technology, because I think we're good in that area, too.
Very good. Hi. One of the things we take pride in at Moines Keith is our high-quality level of customer service that we can offer our clients. We often find that there's this misconception out there that the relationship between a client and an auditor needs is adversarial in some way, and we don't feel that that's the case. We work hard to develop relationships with our clients to make sure we understand their needs and, you know, are there for them whenever any questions arise, not just when we're here for the during the audit time, but at any time during the year. So we often encourage our clients to reach out to us if an issue arises. You know, it's best that it's addressed at the time that the issue presents itself, so you're not kind of backpedaling when we get, you know, show up for the audit in 3 months and have to figure out how to resolve, you know, the issue that emerged at that point in time. We you know, encourage our clients to reach out to us whenever a question comes up, and we understand that in a lot of instances, they may be time-sensitive issues. So for instance, if you have a payroll issue and you need to resolve it before payroll is processed in, you know, a week or two, we do our best to get back to clients within 24 hours. I mean, unless we're on vacation somewhere at a remote island, you know, either Pat or I will get back to someone within 24 hours. And we haven't taken any vacations lately,
exactly.
So.
No Caribbean islands for you guys?
Right, exactly. We're not allowed to go anywhere without the internet service, so.
Right, that's a requirement of the job. So we really, you know, take pride in the quality service that we offer our clients and really want to be there to help support them for the entire year. We understand that the idea of transitioning to a new CPA form can be seen as a daunting task, and our goal is to make that transition as painless as possible. Nothing ever associated with the audit is completely painless, but you know, our goal is to do the best to relieve some of the, you know, concerns that are associated with that. The way that we feel that we can do that is by proper planning and really sitting down with the departments, and especially the ones that, you know, have a lot of interaction with the auditors and go over the list of items that we need for the audit and where they can, you know, pull that information from and what exactly it is we're looking for. And Pat will talk a little bit more about that in a few minutes. We also employ the latest technology in terms of downloading the city's information directly into an automated trial balance system, which really means that there's less work required from the city audit staff in terms of pulling the data for us, and it provides a really clear transition between the city's numbers and our audit financial statements. If you ever wanted to know what city numbers make up a balance in your financial statements, we can easily pull that information for you. It's really, really awesome. I think it's really exciting.
But then we're geeks, so
that's
how we're
doing
it.
I know,
yeah.
We also use a secure web-based portal, which allows the city staff to upload documents to us at any point in time during the year, or, you know, as they're going through the year and closing process, they can just upload information and we get it, you know, instantly. We get an email and say, you know, these 15 documents have been uploaded. So we can really start working on the audit even before, you know, everything is closed at that point in time. So we have efficiencies there. As Pat mentioned, we have, you know, clients of varying sizes, which results in varying comfort levels in the technology side of things. So we really sit down and work with the clients and figure out what's going to work best, whether it's using the portal or just sending us an email of the information that they have, or even, you know, showing up with a memory stick or a USB drive, whatever you call those things nowadays, and just downloading the information directly into our computer. So we just want to make sure everyone's comfortable with the process and, you know, work with each department independently to get the information that we need. We're also very familiar with the city software, the Munis software, and can work with the departments to, you know, pull a report we need if it's never been done. Yeah.
So, you know, as Sandy said, I mean, my emphasis, and I think our emphasis, is on proper planning and preliminary work. You know, in Northampton, obviously, you've given yourself plenty of lead time for the FY16 audit. I understand because of your charter, which is certainly going out to bid a lot earlier than a lot of places do. So that, you know, clearly it affords your auditor the opportunity to get all the work that needs to get done that has nothing to do with the balance in the account. Get all that work done in, you know, months before year end. So in our case, we would plan to come in April and May and do all of that work. So that would include documenting the internal controls, which is a daunting task. You know, you're a large city. And, you know, it's not only time consuming from our standpoint, it's certainly time consuming on your departments. You know, we try to come up with ways to make that, as Sandy said, as painless as possible. For example, we start with pretty extensive questionnaires and give that to them way ahead of time so they have time to, you know, think through, and they may not know the answers to some of the questions. But that, for us, is a starting point. You know, the only way to really understand the internal controls besides, or in addition to, walking through transactions is to really sit down with somebody and understand what they meant by those answers. And we would, you know, certainly do that for all of the key departments. And for us, the key departments, your auditor, treasurer, collector, assessor, and then depending, and to some extent, your schools. Obviously, you have, you know, a unique situation, unique in the state with Smith Vogue. And that, you know, was a little confusing to me in terms of how, whether it's included in your audits and how, I understand by charter it's there, but then they have separate school committees, you know, so it's unique.
And we have our own retirement system.
Yes, and that was the other, exactly, and that was the other point. I was going to say that's what we do in the spring, is we do our retirement system audits for all of our clients. With a 12/31 year end, obviously you can do soup to nuts and be completely done with it before, you know, your fiscal year, the city's fiscal year even ends. So we would do that. We certainly do the transaction testing. You know, I understand that you want a number of departments reviewed. Whichever departments you select, we would also do that during that time. You know, anything that is not driven by whatever the ending balance happens to be. So I think we would get a big jump start on that. And I think, you know, as Candy said, I mean, I've seen her literally sit down next to the accountant on the immune system software and say, okay, that selection and that report, and here's the parameters, and you know, and then you save it, and then you always have it. So you can just run it again next year. So I think, you know, overall, I mean, I don't want to take anyone's time talking about us, but overall, I think, you know, what I think if you choose to change auditors, I firmly believe that we have the best package to offer you. You know, we have a wealth of resources with us. You have local people, knowledge, we're really good at what we do. And they're people that I think, you know, you and I think your clients would enjoy working with. You know, I enjoy working with them because I wouldn't want to do it otherwise. So, I mean, you know, you get a flavor for who we are. And, you know, beyond, I think, being easy to deal with, personable, you know, we understand what our jobs are. And, you know, we have no problem making an issue of something that there needs to be an issue on. And that's not our focus. You know, our focus is really in helping our clients. So,
mm-hmm. So ready for some questions?
Sure.
We're going to start on this side this time. And Tina Louise start off with questions and work this way.
You also mentioned that, you know, it's often these relationships are viewed as adversarial, and the situation that we're in is feels very much the opposite, that we've had a very good work relationship with a firm for so long that I'm not even sure we know how long.
Yep.
I think it will be a hard transition in some ways for people, and people who are used to working with certain people, and I don't think we're looking for anything adversarial,
right,
or want to inject that into the situation, but perhaps would like a new set of eyes, mm-hmm, just because it has been a very comfortable relationship.
Mm-hmm.
So can you talk a little bit more about how, what you think that transition will be like, or what's been your experience transitioning with a municipality that's been with another firm for so long?
Mm-hmm. I know you had that experience recently, feel free to interject, you know, whenever. I would want to throw out there that that situation of having the same auditor for a great number of years is absolutely not unique in any way in Massachusetts, you know, certainly the environment we work in, Massachusetts municipalities. I think, and just, you can speak to the transition maybe, but, you know, from our perspective, because we've had the same issues raised, for example, from some of our clients, and what we're able to do is change teams, or we change partners. So, and every partner and every team has a slightly different way of looking at things, or, you know, we're all doing the same sort of risk assessment evaluation, but what we focus on or things you pick up on are going to be different, you know, from one team to another or from one partner to another. So that's one way that we have been able to continue the relationships and still have that sort of fresh look. But in terms of like transitioning and what you've experienced.
Right. Yeah, we have a very comprehensive list of engineers that we send to the client for the audit, and we take the time to really sit with all the department heads and like Pat said, walk through all our questionnaires and find out what concerns them and what areas maybe they want us to look at or issues that have come up in the past. I mean, when we're doing the walkthrough and the questionnaires, we're talking about, you know, how do you process things, and maybe there's a way we can make that more efficient. And we really, that's what we love most about our job, honestly. I mean, like I said, I love the numbers, but I really enjoy, you know, figuring out a way to make someone's life a little bit easier. And you know, obviously, our focus is on the internal controls of the city and making sure that they're functioning properly and there's the proper checks and balances in place. But I guess that we have a very personal approach, and I feel like we've never had a problem with anyone, it's the term I'm looking for, having an issue with us coming in, even after a long-term auditor.
Right.
You know, we have a very laid-back approach in terms of, you know, really trying to get a feel for what it is they do and not interjecting, oh, well, you should do it this way, or, you know, things like that. We try to understand what it is they're doing and, you know,
Councilor Adams, you have a particular question. Councilor LaBarge? You don't have any questions? So the other thing I wanted to check on, and this has been pretty consistent with everybody, but you caught our two school districts, which is a little unusual. We have our own retirement system, which isn't always the case. And we usually expect our auditor to do our free cash and our balance sheet.
We've done that, and we also have done preparing Schedule A's for our clients. For us, the trick of that is to make sure that everybody's clear in terms of independence and what we're allowed to do and not allowed to do. So we have certainly assisted in preparing free cash certification and balance sheets for free cash certification. Really, for us, it's a matter of making sure things like, are all the reserves there and that sort of thing. And I think one of the great things about the software that we use is that, we get a fairly simple Excel that we get from the city, and then we can create whatever reports we want out of it. So that's typically what we use when to create a free cash balance sheet. We'll take that, we'll make sure, the balances are what they're supposed to be, and send it back in a different format, unaudited, looking like the way the VOR expects it to look. Mm-hmm.
So. And you have no trouble with the 4 to 6 departments, that we vary?
No. I think, I guess I had a question about what your, as a group do you act as the audit committee?
Well, you generally report to us, mm-hmm. and then sometimes to the whole city council. We're the finance committee.
Okay, yes, great.
Thank Councilor Barnes, you have a question?
Yes. Is your firm willing to negotiate a price with us?
Yes.
You are?
Yep.
Also, I have one more question. Have you had the opportunity to look at the previous audit reports that's on the city website?
Yes.
What would you do differently since you read that?
In terms of the audit report itself? I think our approach on, I'll give you an example. The unique situation with Smith Volk is not noted anywhere in your first footnote, which is where you talk about your organization. And I think it's, sort of an important component. So that was one thing that I, that we would modify. The format of it itself would be different. Just in terms of what it looks like, I would say that. In terms of, the bulk of what's there, there's certain disclosures that any audit firm has to make. Investments, what makes it up, and there's obviously standards that we have to live with. So a lot of the meat of that, I think, we would be reporting on as well. I think our footnotes are pretty understandable to people who are not financial people. We try to think about that when we're developing them and writing them, because they're really not, they're not for people who are well versed in financial statements for the most part. I mean, obviously, like Standard & Poor's, bond, rate setting agencies, DOR, they know what you're talking about. But you put it on a website and someone wants to see, understand what's going on. Is there a liability? What does it mean? Those are the ones you're writing the footnotes for. Mm-hmm.
And finally, do you have any other questions for us?
I do have a question on the departmental reviews and what your expectation is of that. Because from in my world, a departmental review can be anything from what we normally do within an audit, which is we go into the department, we look at what records they have, we look at things like the physical security of any cash that they collect, do they have a receipt log, is there some way to double check that what they're handing over is what they should be handing over, is there a separation between cash and check, that sort of thing, is it permitting, is it numbered, is what we would anticipate doing. Mm-hmm. Whatever findings we have from that or recommendations that we have from that would appear in your regular management letter in a format of saying improve controls over the building inspector's office and that's what you should do. There's that, and then there's sort of the other end of the spectrum where I spend 3 days in a department and look at absolutely everything that has to do with that department and then generate a report that could be 10 pages long. So part of when you were requesting, review of the departments, I guess, to me, the truth of the matter is the best audits that you're gonna have is gonna be based on communication between your body and your auditor. And whether that's you've had them for 20 years or you've had them for, 1 year. Mm-hmm. if I can explain to you what the scope of an audit really is, another big misunderstanding what an audit does and doesn't do, you know, if I can communicate that to you in a way that it, you, not that you understand, obviously you understand it, but so that there is a misconception that we're doing all this stuff when we're not actually doing all this stuff. And then getting from you as a body, what are your concerns? What do you want us looking at? Where do you see the fraud risks? How do you evaluate that internally? You know, a lot of the auditing standards that have changed over the years in the last, not even that long ago, big focus on risk, but not only our risk, like audit risk. Risk, what are you as a body doing to evaluate your own risks? You know, looking at, you know, it's very contrary to government organizations, because you know you're not about making money, you're not a business, you know, you're there for the public good, you have a fiduciary duty, but you're also a $100 million business, you know, you're an operation with that size, and so being thoughtful about looking at all your departments, like, well, who's receiving cash, where are the controls, where are our risks, and doing that as a body. I think that is, you know, that's what the standards have been focusing on, is that's your responsibility as a body, and it's our job to communicate that to you. But I think, you know, setting expectations and understanding what we see our role as, how can we help you, and then, you know, understanding what we see your role be, and having that communication, I think that makes all the world a difference in the quality of, in making sure that we're not only doing our jobs, but we're doing the stuff that you feel is important as well.
Well, I mean, obviously, you can just spend a lot of time with the auditor, with the collector, with the
right.
The financial departments of the
course.
City. You're going to spend a lot of time with them.
Mm-hmm.
But I think the level that we want you to deal with another department might depend on your management letter. You know, your management
right.
One letter might lead us to say, next year we want you to go look at, you know, how REC is handling the registration fees for their events, because
right.
you indicated something was lax there,
right.
or fires permitting fees, or
exactly.
buildings permitting fees,
yep.
or whatever. So
yep.
I think above and beyond the primary departments you spend your time with every year would
right.
be keyed up off your management letter saying
mm-hmm.
next year, I think we, based on your recommendations, we need you to spend more time here,
right.
there, or somewhere else.
Yeah.
So that's, I think, where
okay.
you know, the 4 to 6 would be, if your management letter tells us one year that we need to do something, we may next year say, you're gonna have to spend more time with
right.
those folks
right.
and get deeper into what's going
sure.
on there.
Sure, okay.
All right, well, thank you.
All right,
thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
For some reason, I thought you were Joyce from here.
I'm not sure how to respond to this.
Well,
hands
on
that.
Want me to put my glasses on?
As part of the RFP process, like I told you too, so 18 years from now, someone has all the questions down. Right?
I know, it's a daunting task.
Yes.
So the Finance Committee you know, is in front of you, and one member shy. We're running a few minutes behind schedule,
okay.
but
we afforded him the chance
up to the chair.
They decided to build it somewhere.
Okay.
Right.
We'll have you speak
after
at the podium.
Okay,
okay.
Great.
Okay.
So we
I'm glad this room is air conditioned.
Yes.
The one out there is not. So you can attest to that.
Maybe not in the last meeting, our focus has changed. Divine intervention. Councilor Adams is.
Are we waiting for Councilor Adams? That was the question, Mr.
Oh, yeah, let's wait for that. But where? I mean, it depends on where he went. If he went out the window, maybe we don't wait for him. But I think he went out the door.
Usually people only leave the room after.
Oh, there he is. There he is. We don't want to start without him. So while he's getting back, we're being audio and video recorded. Posterity. And as Pam mentioned, we are the Finance Committee of the City Council. The Charter charges the Council to select an auditing firm. And we're doing this is for 16. We are Council LaBarge, Council Murphy, Council Adams, and Council Leonard Scarra. So why don't you, you'll have your full half hour, why don't you do a presentation that, you know, I'm sure you came to do a presentation, and then we'll have some questions.
No, that'd be great. Can I pass
this up? Sure, absolutely.
Well, first of all, let me start off by saying, first of all, I'm backing up with Clifton Larson now. I want to thank the committee for, first of all, I want to thank the city for this opportunity to submit a proposal for audit services. I thank the committee for inviting me here tonight to speak with you, to tell you a little bit more about our firm and our proposal, and to answer any questions you have. So we're really excited about this opportunity. We really appreciate it. Let me just give you a little bit of background. I won't bore you too much. Sort of let you know sort of how we got to where we're at here with Clifton Larson Allen. Back in 2002, Dan Sullivan and Chris Rogers were with another firm that does state and local government audits in Massachusetts, and they decided to start their own firm with the goal of being 100% dedicated to the Massachusetts state and local government industry. That was back in 2002. I joined that firm back in 2003 and became a partner of Sullivan Rogers and Company in 2008. So from 2002 through 2013, we developed a great reputation here in Massachusetts in the government community. We really grew our practice and felt like we had a very strong practice in the state and local government industry. But what we found is that we felt like in order to continue to grow, continue to provide ourselves with more opportunities in this market, we wanted to explore the idea of possibly merging with another firm. To give us even more opportunities than we had. During that process, we came across a firm called Clifton Larson Allen. The reason why Clifton Larson Allen, and I'll abbreviate it to CLA, so I'm going to keep saying that. The reason why CLA was very appealing to us is that they shared a lot of the same beliefs and philosophies that we had. We believe that in order to really serve the Massachusetts state and local government industry, you have to be 100% dedicated to it. You can't just dabble in it. You have to be completely focused on it 100% of the time. And we found that CLA also as a firm really believed in specializing in the industries in which you work. And one of the areas that CLA does specialize in is in the state local government market. So not just here in Massachusetts, but nationwide, CLA has a great presence in the state local government industry. Overall, we're the ninth largest CPA firm in the country. We have 3,700 professionals throughout the United States. We have 500 partners throughout the country, 90 offices, including four offices here in Massachusetts. In terms of the state and local government industry nationwide, we have about 450 professionals who are dedicated to this industry, and we perform approximately 2,000 engagements annually, both audits, consulting engagements, all different types of services for government organizations. In terms of nationally, again, we audit approximately 100 comprehensive annual financial reports throughout the country. Here in Massachusetts, we audit about 8 of those particular reports. And many of our state and local government leaders are members of the Government Finance Officers Technical Review Team, including myself. So we consider ourselves to be, again, experts in the area of state and local government auditing and financial reporting. Also nationwide, we are the leader in performing single audits. As of 2012, the most recent data that was available, our firm performed the most single audits of any firm in the country, approximately 900 single audit engagements through 2012. We've also been involved in a lot of AICPA single audit task forces related to the single audit. We feel like we've been a leader in this area. When the new regulations came out, many of you may have heard them as the Super Circular or the Omni Circular. We were very much on top of that. We conducted webinars with our clients. We also developed a proprietary information implementation checklist so that our clients could help implement those new standards. That sort of gives you a little bit of an idea of who we are nationally. Locally, again, because we're part of Sullivan Rogers and Company emerged into CLA, that's where our local presence comes into play. We perform approximately 50 annual audits of government organizations or quasi-government organizations in Massachusetts on an annual basis. Many of our audit clients have the city form of government, like the city of Northampton. Some of our city clients include Brockton, Chelsea, Fall River, Newton, Waltham, and Worcester. I want to tell you a little bit about the engagement team that we've assigned to the city of Northampton. We feel like we've assigned a very talented and experienced team to your audit. Myself will be the managing partner on the engagement. That basically means I'll be overseeing the entire engagement. I'll be coordinating and overseeing all meetings with client personnel. And one of my key roles will be, and I feel like this is really important, is that I'm not just going to be available during the audit. I'm available throughout the entire year to assist your people with any questions or concerns they may have. So it's not just, you know, available during the audit. It's throughout the entire year I can be a resource to the city. Overall, I have 17 years of experience in this industry. I've dedicated my entire career to state and local government in Massachusetts. Some of the audits that I've been a manager and partner on over the years include Worcester, Newton, Chelsea, Town of Bedford, Town of Sudbury, and the Town of Winchester. Another person who isn't listed on the proposal as being part of the audit team, but I do want to point out that he could be a really valuable resource to the city, and I think it's one of the things that sets us apart from the competition, is one of the partners in our firm, Dan Sullivan. I would consider him to be an expert in the MUNIS system that the city of Northampton uses. He has 20 years of experience with that program. He has a real passion for the MUNIS program. It's something that he really enjoys helping clients with that system. He's assisted a lot of communities with implementing the MUNIS system. And he also regularly attends Tyler Technologies annual conference. He's a member of several MUNIS user groups. And I can tell you from experience, for some of my audit clients that use MUNIS, they are constantly leaning on Dan to help them with questions throughout the year, help them with certain aspects of the software program. So I do think that that would be, will be a very valuable resource to the city and something that will set us apart from our competitors. Another couple of things that I think set us apart from our competitors is because we are a national firm, one of the things that we do with all of our audits is that we have what is called a quality control review partner on all of our audits. Now, every firm has sort of a second review that may be done internally, but it's done with someone who's down in the office down the hall, who may have been involved in the audit in some way, shape, or form previously anyway. With us, all of our audits are reviewed by a partner in an office completely separate from our office, somewhere outside of the state of Massachusetts, who has state and local government expertise. They can be a real true fresh set of eyes on your audit to make sure that the audit is complying with standards. So for the city of Northampton, your quality reviewer will be Keith Novak. Keith has been in this industry for 33 years. He's been the partner or quality review partner on many large engagements, including several of our larger clients here in Massachusetts, as well as the state of Pennsylvania and the state of South Carolina. Another aspect that I think segregates us from the competition is that because we're a national firm, we have a lot of experts in a lot of different areas. One of the areas that we have expertise in is information technology. And so now, as part of most of our larger audits, the city of Northampton included, we've been putting information technology specialists on the audit so that they can look into your IT systems as it relates to financial reporting. And I've found since we've been with CLA that having IT specialists on the audit has really helped come up with some great recommendations that our clients have really appreciated. So you'll be getting on your audit, Jim Kreiser will be your information technology resource partner. And he has 18 years of experience in this field. And again, he's assisted in the IT portion of audits for several of our larger clients. The rest of your engagement team, the audit manager, will be Tom Ventulo. He's a CPA who has 8 years of experience, all dedicated to Massachusetts local government. He's performed and managed well over 100 government audits throughout his career. Some of his prominent clients include Brockton, Chelsea, and Worcester. And lastly, your senior on the engagement will be Jim Piotrowski. He's both a CPA and also a certified government finance manager. He has 4 years of experience, all with Massachusetts governments. He's worked on clients such as the City of Worcester, City of Gloucester, and the City of Newton. Lastly, a couple other things that I wanted to point out that I do feel like separate us from the competition. One thing that I think could probably be a concern for the city is because you've had the same auditor, I believe, for the past 18 years, I'm sure that there's some concern over what's going to be like to transition to a new audit firm. We have significant amount of experience with this because we have so many people who have been dedicated their entire careers to state local government. We've been involved in many, many transitions as a new audit firm for a lot of different governmental clients. I do want to point out one particular client. I know we gave you references for all our different clients. If there was one client that you wanted to talk about that recently transitioned to CLA as their new audit firm, I would encourage you to talk to the city of Rockton. They transitioned to us as their audit firm in 2014. So I think they can give you some valuable insight into what their experience was like. So we help mitigate any transition issues to a new audit firm. One of the ways that we do that is in year one of the audit, we'll have increased involvement from myself and also the manager on the job. We'll also probably initiate maybe a few more planning type meetings than maybe we normally would, because again, we are trying to learn and understand the city of Northampton. You're also trying to understand our approach. So we feel like it's really important to communicate even more so in year one during the transition year. We also provide you with very detailed checklists that make it very clear what we expect from all the different departments in terms of the information that we need for the audit. We also try to help minimize your workload by providing you with templates that you can fill out instead of making you have to perform original work. We try to provide you with templates that'll make it easier for you to provide what we need. And again, constant communication throughout the audit is very important. Also, because CLA is a national firm, we can offer you some value-added services above and beyond just the audit. We offer many educational and informative resources throughout the year to keep you current on emerging issues and industry standards. We issue newsletters throughout the year, and they're not just canned newsletters from some other company. They're developed by people internally who are experts in the industry and can provide you with a lot of valuable information. We also offer a lot of training resources, both outside seminars and also webinars as well. That's all free of charge. That's all included in your audit fee. And lastly, I did want to point out your RFP does have certain criteria to be labeled as highly advantageous. So I just wanted to summarize why we feel like we're highly advantageous to the city. In terms of our auditor experience, we have 7 CPAs with at least 3 years of experience with Massachusetts governments. 3 of those CPAs have been assigned to the city's audit. In terms of manager and partner experience, we have combined 25 years of experience. But then on top of that, your quality review partner has 33 years of experience, and your IT resource partner has 18 years of experience. So you're really talking about over 75 years of experience at the manager and partner level. In terms of our municipal audit experience, we have well over 30 town, city, school, retirement audits in Massachusetts, as well as about 15 to 20 other audits of governmental organizations. And then in terms of the size of the municipalities that we audit, we have approximately 15 audits where the general fund revenues are over $50 million. So we do feel very strongly that not only are we highly advantageous based on the city's RFP criteria, but based on some of the things that I pointed out that I think really separate us from the competition, we really do feel like we're really the best fit for the city.
Great. Ready for some questions?
Absolutely.
We'll start with Councilor LaFarge.
What do I want to ask? Did you have a chance or the opportunity to look at the previous audit reports on the city website?
I did.
And if you have, what kind of changes would you do?
Well, it's funny you ask, because I do have a couple of things that I wrote down as things that sort of jumped out at me when I read through, particularly the financial statements. And one thing that I did notice, and this sometimes happens, you certainly don't want it to happen, but I did notice that last year, there was a restatement of the financial statements for about $5 million for landfill closure costs that had been previously capitalized as assets. So again, I don't know really the background behind that restatement, but obviously you'd like to try to avoid that as much as you can, having a prior period restatement. A couple of things I noticed is that you have a community preservation fund. That fund has a legally adopted budget. In accordance with GAAP, funds that have a legally adopted budget other than even just the general fund should report a budget to actual statement. So that's something that I would recommend if we were to be your auditors, is we'd probably start reporting a budget to actual statement for your CDA fund. In terms of a couple other things that I noticed that could be potential improvements, your budget to actual statement for your general fund just had an original budget column and a final budget column. What we like to do to sort of see all the different aspects that go into the making up of the budget is we actually show prior year encumbrances and carry forwards from the previous year, original voted budgets, supplemental appropriations, and then your final budget so that you can see all the different progressions that got you to your final budget. So that's something that we would recommend to start to report moving forward. Also notice that your long-term debt footnote basically just shows ending balances in principal. We would also recommend showing beginning balances, the amount of bonds issued in the current year, the amount of bonds redeemed in the current year, and then your ending balance. Again, I think it just gives a little bit more information that shows you how you got from your balance at the beginning of the year to the end. A couple other things, there's a footnote in the financial statements that talks about interfund transfers between funds. What we notice is that it's basically just a table of all the different transfers. What we like to do with our transfers footnote is actually show narrative descriptions of what all the different transfers represent, because we feel like it gives the reader sort of an idea of why these funds are being moved around. And then the only other thing, and this is just more so of a formatting thing, maybe it's just a me thing, I don't necessarily like the use of landscape on reports, because as you're flipping through the reports, there are certain financial statements of the landscape, you gotta turn it around, then you flip the page, you gotta turn it around. From a presentation perspective, I particularly like having everything in portrait style, so that basically as you're flipping through, you never have to turn the report over. So again, that could just be me. But those are some things that I noticed. Again, not being critical, but those are just some things that maybe we would recommend changes to.
Thank you.
Councilor Adams?
This is a strong proposal, I think. There were other strong proposals, too. And one of the things I noticed in some of the others were the other firms took the opportunity to familiarize themselves with Northampton. Have you had the opportunity to do that?
Absolutely. I've tried as best I could. It's been a quick turnaround. But yes, I have tried to familiarize myself with the city.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Councilor Scarrett?
And you're traveling from where again?
I'm personally, our office is located in Lexington. We have four offices in the state. But basically, the state and local government expertise is mainly out of the Lexington, Massachusetts office.
And well, do you feel like travel is going to be challenging to, you know, to do the site visits?
I think obviously, you know, it's a challenge. I don't know if I'd call it a challenge. I can tell you that as a frame of reference, we do audits down at the Cape. We do audits down at Martha's Vineyard. We do the audit of the Fall River. So we have audits throughout the state, so it's not uncommon for us to have to travel. I think when you have that situation, you know, you certainly try to come up with ways that you can maybe perform parts of the audit remotely, but we'll be on site as much as we need to be, and we're not gonna let travel be an issue.
We've been with the firm that we use now for quite a while, and so there's concern about what the transition's gonna look like, and just, you know, we hope it will be as easy on the departments as possible. Can you talk a little bit more about what that approach will be?
Well, like I said, I think the key to it all really comes down to communication. I know that sounds sort of cliche, but it's really true, because if everybody's on the same page about what it is that we're expecting and what the city's expecting from us, I really think it goes a long, long way. And I think, especially in year one of the transition year, having actual face-to-face meetings becomes a little bit more important. I can tell you from recent experience, it's a different type of client, but one of our new clients this past year that I was the partner on, we had, again, maybe a few more of those face-to-face, what I'd call planning meetings, than maybe we normally would. And I think it just went such a long way, because not only do you get to get an understanding of what it is we're expecting and vice versa, but I also think, again, it sounds cliche, but I also think it helps build a relationship, which I also think is really important. I think it's really important for you to, you know, a lot of auditors have a reputation of being very robotic and being, you know, maybe not the nicest people, but I actually think it's really important to build that relationship so that the city trusts its auditors. You know what you're expecting from us. So that's really, I think, the number one thing that we do in the transition year. And again, we try to make it as simple as possible in the sense that if there's a particular documents that you already have in place that maybe aren't exactly what we'd normally be looking for, but it serves the purpose, well, then we would accept that. Like, those are the types of things that we do, is we try not to give you, we try not to overburden you with original work. We try to work with what you have and make it fit into our equation. So again, communication, you know, trying to be creative with the types of information that we're looking for, trying to take advantage of what you already have in place. Those are the types of things that I help think and really help ease the transition.
Counselor,
do you have another question?
Yes. Is your firm willing to negotiate what's the price that you're proposing?
Yes, absolutely. It's up to discussion.
If you're one of our more expensive options.
Yeah.
What's that?
You're one of our more expensive options. That's a good question for us. And the big things I want to make sure you caught, we're unusual. We have two school districts, which not everybody does. We have our own retirement system.
Yeah.
You're good with all of that.
Okay.
And we usually have our auditor take the lead on our free cash and balance sheet reports. You're good with that.
Is that part of the audit as well?
Yeah. And we like to often have you take a closer look at 4 to 6 different departments. Obviously, you work closely with the auditor and the collector and the assessor and financial departments. But based on a management letter, sometimes we like to have you look more in depth into, you know, 2 other departments, let's say, that seem to be warranted that we agree on. Is that it?
Yes. Yeah, I mentioned, I saw that in the RFP. Yeah. That can be somewhat of a common part of the audit, is some of our clients would like us to look at sort of some of those non-traditional departments to recommend improvements and things of that nature.
Okay. And finally, do you have any questions for us before we wrap it up?
I guess other than, you know, obviously you've had the same audit firm for a long period of time, so I'm assuming that's sort of the primary reason for going out to bid. Is there any other particular reason why the city's decided to go out to bid?
We've been sad. I mean, we're in our second generation of this audit firm, so we've used them for a very long time. And I think it's just a due diligence. Our new charter puts it upon us to do this, and we've started early because it's the 16th audit we're talking about.
Right.
But we wanted to see, you know, what was out there, what people would suggest were different. We're not dissatisfied with our auditor. We just wanted to see what, you know, what we get from an RFP from other people who might be interested in doing business with us.
Sure.
So this doesn't result at all from dissatisfaction. It's sort of a new thing for us under our new charter, so we wanted to be diligent to have.
There you go. And so what do you think are some of the most important qualities that you would like to see in your audit firm?
I think one of our greatest concerns because of the change is flexibility in the beginning to work with our departments to get everybody up to speed, because they're very comfortable with what they need to produce for our current audit firm. And while we would change for the sake of new eyes, it would be the council's decision to change. We don't really want that to wreak havoc with the departments. You know, it's going to be different, and we want you to take the time to work with them so that the change is a positive one. You know, we're saying, gee, we want new eyes, but I don't necessarily know that all the departments are delighted with that concept. So when all is said and done, we'd like them to feel like, oh, that wasn't so bad. I guess that wasn't a bad idea.
And I think you put it in terms that are kind of what I was trying to convey as well. And like you said, they're used to providing information a certain way, a certain format. Yeah. That's where we would be flexible and say, well, that works for us too. And, you know, in certain areas where it doesn't work for us, well, that's kind of the whole point of having a new audit firm, is you do want maybe sort of challenge the old way of doing things in certain ways, but it's only when it makes sense to challenge it. We're not going to challenge it just for the sake of challenging and say, hey, with a new sheriff in town, you know, this is the way we do it. You know, that's not how we operate. And so I think it would be a smooth transition.
Okay, so that's really our concern. We feel like we're doing our due diligence, but we don't want it to be at the expense of our departments.
Right.
You know, needless to say, you know, DOR has its way with most of the financial ones. And I think you're pretty worn out from that. We don't want to make it any worse than it has to be.
Agreed.
All right. Well, thank you for your time. Thank you for coming out to see us.
No, thank you very much for the opportunity. I really appreciate it.
All right.
All right. Have a good night.
What's your bag?
Oh, thank you.
I I've seen 100 to 1, yeah. Yeah, so, again, originally we didn't think we needed to speak to him, but in the end, I guess it was decided it was fair to have him come in. And, that's good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
How's everyone doing?
We're doing good. We're a little we're a little bit worn out though, so we're gonna be easy for you. We're a little bit worn out.
I'm worn out too. It's hot out there. Okay, cool though.
Mm-hmm. So what we're doing here, the new charter says that we hired an auditor, and so we wanted to be diligent about it as a a diligent city council and put out an RFP and get some folks. We are not in any way dissatisfied with what you've done for us. We're just being diligent since we have this responsibility looking around.
Yeah, yeah.
So we did let everybody else make a presentation to us. We're, you know, as I said, we in our departments kind of know what to expect from your audit. We're not dissatisfied with it. So if there's anything you want to present to us.
Yeah, I can come with a presentation.
Okay, that's fine.
Enjoy working for the city.
And we didn't ask for it because we know what to expect.
That's right. Yeah, I understand the concerns. I know there's concerns out there about switching on firms. I know. I think that's kind of just a generic label they put on a lot of firms coming out of Sarbanes-Oxley. As an audit firm, we try to be objective every year. We do a lot of things. We don't do computerized electronic where we download all your files, it's our files. We do a lot of analyzation on spreadsheets. We feel like we get to look at every account. We do a lot of analytical, dive into deep, especially budget versus actuals. We have a lot of clients that, we have a 10 plus year relationship with. I think that says a lot about our work. Not a lot of towns and cities are willing to go away from us. We believe in audit throughout the whole year, not just showing up for 2 weeks and doing an examination of your financial statements. We really put an emphasis on encouraging the calls throughout the year. Really working with the staff, developing a relationship. I don't think that impedes our integrity or objectivity. As I said before, my wife was town accountant, she was doing something outside of internal controls. I would be the first one to write her up. So I feel strongly too. Again, some of the things we do, we don't have the same people doing the same thing over and over again. For instance, we buried up the same person's not doing receivables. We try to get out of it 3 years, so it's the same person is doing that 3 years in a row. We take them off that and try to move them to cash or for receivables. I know there's a lot of, our audit fee, we have factored into there. Work that we do, especially with the city, you see an increase in it, is work that we do with free cash. That's above and beyond an audit. I know there's various things that popped up in the city throughout the years that we did not charge for. So we like to roll that all into, for instance, you have a new collector coming on board. We talked about the transition on that. I believe we retired on June 29th, but we're going to roll all that work into this year's audit, so it's savings to the city, where technically it's separate engagements, agreed upon procedures, say as rules out there that if you have a change in collectors, you have to have go through an audit, you have to be committed to the assessors. A lot of things like that we like to build into the audit, so it's cost savings in that regard. Some of the other aspects I've heard throughout the years, that's good to change auditors because they want to find it's good from a fraud aspect. That's not what we do. Our sole objective is not to find fraud, and I think that's the basic expectation you have to get a client is associating audit and fraud. We do a lot of consideration of fraud with analytical to dive deeper into categories. But when you look at the fraud examiner's statistics that came out in 2014, the external audit is responsible for finding 3% of the fraud. By mistake is 6%. So that says a lot. It's really management's controls. So if your objective on switching audit firms is to find fraud, you're looking at just 3%. If you're really going to be effective, you should switch all the personnel you have in place every 5 years. That accounts for 30%. So, there's stuff to put it. I I understand, find it, the argument. I think it's just, I think you've got to communicate with the auditor. It's always constant communication, which we've always had here. That's the objective, is what am I doing? I think we look at our time. I think we come up with a budget every year. That time is not diminished in over 10 years. It's not like we have 490 hours, now we're down to 200 hours, and you hear complaints from department staff, you're not seeing us. Well, yeah, that's the case. You probably, I am getting too complacent. And I feel the firm, we don't do that. We have staff meetings. We're always on top of things. So, you know, I would say the thing about switching out of firms, I always bring up, I just had an argument up, tell me I'm on it, convinced so, was, do you switch doctors every 3 or 4 years? And the answer to that, because he gave me, was no. I think that's your health. Once you think you have second opinion, your health, you want a second set of eyes. So don't limit to my profession. I think that has a lot of politics that came up from behind it, but I did a switch. You can basically put that over every profession that you want to. I think some can be just as complacent being here 1 year as they can be 10 years. But in my opinion, it's a matter of being communication and really monitoring as management. But I think it's always a good idea to go out and get, but I think it's just general practice. Go out and check the prices we have.
Mm-hmm. Questions? Counselor, do you have any questions?
What are we going to ask? I want to thank you, Tom, for serving our city for 25 years. And I've worked with you for 18 years, going on 18 years. I have never heard of any of our previous mayors that I've worked with or the financial team of feeling uncomfortable with you. I have seen you come to City Council and present to city councilors of our financing situation in the city. I've also talked with some of the department heads from year to year who have told me that you sit with them and you explain to them how a change will be made and put them in a direction that is in the right direction. I want to thank you for all the years of service.
Counselor Adams, do you have any questions?
I have a point, not a question. Your firm is still the cheapest, and we're certainly familiar with you, and you guys have been very good. And I think it makes your argument stronger that you don't have the same people doing the same things all the time. Today we've heard auditors compared to doctors and lawyers, and I don't really believe either are adequate analogies, because I don't know of it being a best practice to switch a lawyer or a doctor who's for a new set of eyes after a period of time. But it really comes down to us weighing whether or not a new set of eyes and best practices is worth the extra money. So
yeah, the question I have for you is, who sets the best practices? I think you have to go back to their intentions. I've seen a lot of
I don't think it's only to discover fraud. I think it's to, you know, new perspectives and new eyes. I don't think it's solely to discover fraud.
We're applying that to financial statements. I mean, in the world of government, everything's so compliance-oriented. Other arguments I've heard, for instance, is, well, maybe the auditor could give us a better perspective on how do we need 100 computers in a classroom or building a school. But that's not what an audit is. An audit is applying on your financial statements.
Right.
There's not a lot of, again, you have to, where the intention came from on best practice, who came up with that? And what their intentions were, what is the best practice on that? I think it came out of Sarbanes-Oxley, and they came out, came out of Enron, where you had one bad group of auditors that was in with, they were greedy, which I think was greedy in every profession. So our profession is so reactionary, it labeled all of us as you're not objective after 10 years. Well, I don't think you can get too many audit firms saying, one thing that upsets me is when I hear other audit firms saying it, but yet they've been a client for 10 plus years, so they go tell their own client you should switch. No, I think it's more turned into an advertising type thing, kind of a sales thing. That's my opinion on it. But yeah, no, you shouldn't limit to my profession. It's good to get set eyes on every
for the record, none of the people we talked to today said it was particularly advantageous to change. They said if you have a comfortable relationship with the auditor and it's working, we can't say changes for the hell of it.
Oh, yeah. I mean, it's, hey, you got four quality firms here.
Yeah.
That's like three quality firms. Hmm. If they're a quality firm, I wouldn't expect any of those three to say that.
Councilor Scarrett, do you have any questions?
No, I don't think I have a question. I mean, just kind of to continue with that point. I mean, what I think what you're saying is that, you know, you're opining on our financial statements, so there's not a lot of creativity in that. Like, but it doesn't mean you couldn't have differences of opinion, right?
Oh, I mean, yeah, but definitely. I mean, you could get all four of our firms that will have differences of opinion. How we,
so, I mean, I think that's what we're talking about when we're talking about a new set of eyes, just that it's, you know, different people have different perspectives.
Oh, I understand the argument. You should all limit to me. You should limit to everything. I mean, I've come across Gavakati's arguments over and over again. If you believe it, you believe it. I got no issues with that, but I mean, saying it because...
What you do is kind of a specific... I mean, it's different than a lawyer or a doctor in that your job is to kind of go in and review what's been done, which is kind of... I mean, it's a different... While I agree maybe it shouldn't just be limited to auditors, I think it's there's some things specific about that kind of work. No,
I'm not too sure. You have doctors looking at different x-rays, you got, I mean, sure. As I said, I may pick up something that the same sort of thing on my end. I mean, that's the argument is different set of eyes, different ways of looking at your controls are your controls. You know, your same bank accounts, your same bank accounts. If you're not balancing your cash, I think any auto firm's gonna come and say not balancing your cash. That's a significant account. I think when you get to your outlier accounts or maybe personnel files where as a firm we don't think the I-9 form is that big of a deal in your personnel file, or other firms may say, hey, you know, that's a compliance issue, I think that we should have in here. Can we get to those avenues? Yes. I think on the major control aspects of things, I'm not too sure in the government sector. Too many varying opinions on that. When you get out to the private sector, you get out SEC trading, yes, there's a whole lot of, when you look at stock equity and looking at the measurement of those things, yeah, I think different set of eyes on that prospect. I can see that argument. You come to the governmental arena, so many compliance and governance above your audit perspective. I think the argument kind of minimizes, in my opinion. I understand the arguments.
Anybody have any other particular questions? Are we good? Any more questions for us?
No.
Okay. And again, we make a recommendation, and this is the first time we've done this at finance because the new charter specifically says that we're the ones that have to do this. So that's why for the first time we figured we'd do the drill.
Oh, yeah, no, I think it's a good idea. I've encouraged a couple of my accounts to go out too. I mean, should go out, get prices down. What's out there in different perspective. The only thing I'd say to keep in mind is this, an audit is an audit. And what you do outside, like helping with free cash, helping towards that, and then consulting. There's GAAP fees, which is your GAAP accounting, and then there's the state zone regulations that probably is not really a GAAP. A lot of compliance issues on that we are consulting on. And again, as we go on, say, free cash, if we're helping consulting with the free cash avenue, we are documenting the state charter in place to ensure that we don't control efficiency. That's not a competence issue type thing.
Very good. Thank you.
That's it.
Thank you, Tom.
No problem. Hopefully, he'll make a ruling on Brady.
We'll see if we start next week. But they play, actually, they play Thursday night, so we want to have an expeditious meeting so we can go watch the last preseason game. No, I think it's
Thursday.
No, the season starts. Thursday is a preseason game, and then the season starts right after Labor Day.
Yeah, I only play the Giants preseason this Thursday.
This Thursday.
Yeah. It's hard to believe. It goes by quick.
Hopefully, Bill won't be lonely.
Maybe the sunshine.
Okay.
See ya.
Thanks, Tom.
Yeah, if you have any questions, don't take them.
Okay.
I didn't mean to offend anyone.
Nope. Thanks for coming. So did everybody get this analysis here?
Yeah.
from Emily? Yeah.
Yeah. Because that, I think you got to go the other way because of the alarm.
Oh,
this way,
that'll set the alarm up.
That set the alarm. You got to go that way now. We moved the cheese. So everybody's got the prices, because this is something, the meeting you weren't here, we had Pam do some work for us and come up with, you know, because did they include all the federal audits? Did they get the school district? So the original pricing became very, very different
right.
once Pam did the due diligence of figuring out what they really cost.
The resulting grand total was?
So the very,
the last
yes,
one is the one.
Yeah,
the
so
one
this one.
The 200,000
yeah.
mm-hmm. cameras, a little bit less.
So yeah. with that analysis, Tom and his company come out the least expensive, which we sort of figured because they got a handle on what they're doing here because they've been doing it forever and ever and ever.
And this is over 3 years.
This is a 3 year.
And
audit.
What did we pay them last year, or what are we paying them for this?
61.5, not to exceed
61.5.
Okay, but
61.
When you but the do we have
6.1.
6.1 for 1 year.
Okay.
All right, and that's 15, which is the one that, and they're already doing that.
Right.
So this is for 16, 17, and 18.
So let me just clarify, because you're asking, what is that? How come that six so low?
Well, I mean, do we have like a comparable resulting grand total?
Okay, so what the pricing matrix that was sent to people, we asked them to level fund. So if it was 72.5 1 year, it would be 72.5 for the following 3 years. So to figure out what their charges would be for 1 year, you have to divide that by 3
mm-hmm.
to get the cost.
Yeah. So in this document, what happens is on page 3, there's the base amount.
Mm-hmm.
Then there's the schools. Then you add in the 7 federal audits. So the resulting grand total is actually the bottom line for everything. And those, we had to do that because their proposals before weren't all equal because they didn't all include everything.
Right.
So the $2,500 for Mendelsohn and Heath, the Clifton Larson $214,500, the Powers and Sullivan $207,000, and the Scanlon $196,600 is the totals for the same amount of work from everybody.
For 3 years.
Okay. And that lineup is very different than the other one.
Yep.
So it's good that we went, and that Pam was kind enough to do that deal for us. So just philosophically, something that I mentioned to Councilor Adams, who I talked to at the time. When making the decision to switch or not to switch, I think we should turn over to the council. And this is just for discussion. I think what we might do is turn over Scanlon as the low bidder and the current auditor, and then make a recommendation out of the other three, which is the other one. You know, if you want to change, here's what you change to based on our meeting with you. So here's what you have now, which is the lowest price. And here of the other three, if you're going to switch for the sake of new eyes, here's the other one. And then let all the counselors decide based on what the cost would be. I mean, every one of them got good references. Every one of them could do the job. They all know each other. I think they know that. But of the bunch, Powers and Sullivan, the first one we talked to, is only $10,400 above Scanlon. So that's the closest one financially
right.
to what the Scanlon bid is. The other thing that follows our decision is the school districts who pay their share of that have to chase whoever we pick.
Right.
So, you know, we may say, well, we don't mind the 10 grand, but some of that is their money.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
and
right.
so if we decide to gratify ourselves with changing, they're stuck following suit.
Are they
and
bound
pay
to the
more.
Same auditor?
Yeah. Yeah, they have to use the same auditor.
They have to?
Yeah.
I'm told they don't have to use the same auditor,
the same
and if they
job.
Don't like the prices, they may choose to
really,
choose
I thought they always had the followers.
So, they always have. They always have used the same auditors, but they're not required to. So if you look at just those 7 audits that you're referring to,
mm-hmm.
I shouldn't be speaking here. But
no, please.
I'm going to
this
speak about these 7 federal audits.
Mm-hmm.
If you look at the prices where
they
the
vary.
Have submitted
yeah.
their proposals for the 7 audits.
This is on page 3.
I think that's where you're going to get the most bang for your buck as far as asking them to negotiate the price. Because you see Scanlon at 26.6, what is it that they do that's so inexpensive compared to Powers and Sullivan, which is nearly double the price? That's, you know, I don't really understand the audits enough, and I'm not, you know, I don't really know why there's such a big discrepancy.
Although the schools, you know, all of them are $30,000 except for Scanlon, who's $3,000 less than that. So the school component of it is pretty consistent.
Right.
You know, it really is the federal audits that are so different. Mm-hmm. But what do you think about the philosophy of?
I agree that narrowing down makes sense. We've had an advantage of seeing them, and I don't think the council will. And I just think that's. I agree.
Well, how about we go around and just rate the other three with what we, you know, maybe we have consensus of the other ones we saw, who did each of us like the best, you know, rate them 1, 2, 3,
sure,
and see if we have any.
I thought Powers and Sullivan for several reasons.
They're your first choice?
Yeah. Well, I mean, with, well, you mean first, the second scale?
Yeah, but first, just random those three. So, if we're going
to
follow the philosophy of sending one other company, which should it be?
And the reason why is because they knew about the landfill, they knew about the stormwater fee, they knew about our school districts. Others knew some. I think they're the only ones who mentioned all of those things. But they mentioned all those things. They can start right away. They already had ideas for additional transparency ideas. And they're willing to negotiate, and they're only, you know, $10,400 more
to start with,
and that's about $3,000 a year. So if we're gonna end up weighing, you know, cost versus new set of eyes and all that,
mm-hmm,
the others were fine. But I just, those.
Who was your second choice?
It would have to be. I didn't really have much of a preference between Lance and Heath and Clifton Larson Allen.
Mm-hmm.
Neither really. They both seem fine, but neither really high, I guess.
What do you think?
I definitely agree that I was most impressed with Powers and Sullivan. I also like that the vast majority of their work is municipal. It's 95%.
Mm-hmm.
It's really what they specialize in. And I thought that they had done the most research, they had the most, you know, comprehensive, polished presentation for us.
Mm-hmm.
And I guess my second choice would be Clifton Larson and Allen. By far, I was most impressed with Powers.
And my feeling was the same.
Yeah.
You know, so I'm agreeing with you that I think Powers Sullivan was number one, and I agree with you that Clifton Allen was number two. What do you think?
Same thing.
The other thing I want to say is just two things. Pam, I think you did a great job.
Yes, definitely.
Really, and just everything, including this last document and suggested questions, which were really good. It's great.
And just for you to know, you know, when we left here at that meeting, theoretically Joe Cook was going to do that.
Right.
But it was really Pam that did all that work and did this analysis for us. So thank you very much. That's a lot of analyticals, and it made a big difference to the bottom line of these companies.
Yeah, when I realized we were having this meeting, and I was like, oh my God. I couldn't figure out anything that I was looking at. I was like, okay.
Yeah. Yeah.
Much better.
So
huh?
Helpful.
Quick catch up.
Yes, it really helped me catch up.
I think what was different was because we had Susan Rory, who was present, who you could talk to and be guided by, and then we were told that the finance committee could no longer.
Well, the finance for the professionals.
Yes, they could not participate from here on, and it was like a panic bell to me because where are we going to get the answers that we actually want? Which we know that Susan worked very, very closely with you, Pam. Thank God for her, because I don't know what we'd do without her.
I just want to add, I'm very disappointed that they weren't here. This committee made a joint request by consensus that they be here, and they were very beneficial last time.
Mm-hmm.
And and emailed to us, the mayor said due to other priorities, they can't, he doesn't want them here and he didn't substantiate. So, you know, I put in a call on Friday to ask him, I never heard back. You know, I can't imagine we'll be a higher priority for the finance team than being present when we're selecting auditors, when we've requested that they be here.
Exactly.
So I really feel that was distasteful.
Yeah. And I mean, obviously the deliberative portion, you know, and the philosophy is that they're the ones being audited, so, you know, that they shouldn't participate in that. But, you know, the deliberative part of it is us. And if we send it this way to council to say, you know, we vetted your best second option, but you decide whether you want to change horses or not, you know? And I think we've done it. I mean, we all seem to have come to the same conclusion after seeing everybody. So do you, Tasha, want to put that in a motion?
Sure. I move that we send forward with a, I guess with a positive recommendation, both Powers and Sullivan and Scanlon and Associates for the council's consideration in choosing the
okay.
audit margin.
Okay, second. Okay. Any more discussion on that? No. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Excellent. So I think
so do you want me to notify the other two? I can formally send them something.
Well, actually, well, maybe we should just wait.
Wait till, because it's coming up.
Yeah.
It's coming up
yeah.
so quick.
I mean, I don't think they've actually been excluded because we don't want them. I think it'd be surprising if the council just chose.
Well, the council could throw it back. I mean, who knows?
Right, right. So, yeah, we can do it just yet.
Go back and, you know, do whatever. I mean, between the last meeting and this meeting, it changed, so maybe it'll change after Thursday.
So my only concern is that, you know, I'm expecting that one of the, at least the firms will call tomorrow to find out what was the outcome.
Well,
really?
I mean,
yeah,
I mean, this is
well,
but frankly, this is public record, so it's
you
a fact.
Tell them just the recommendation. You could just tell them the recommendation.
Yeah.
To send
okay.
these forward to.
Yeah.
Okay.
Because
like,
we this is
notify them after the council vote.
Yeah. Right. If you want, you can also explain that that's as a matter of process, the council still has the ability to consider them all. But
that's our recommendation.
Okay.
Because that is public record, and you know if they call, you don't want to not tell them what's going on. So, any new business?
Nothing
nope.
to adjourn.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you all. Thank you. I think that worked.